In my opinion, those officers did not stand a chance. The fact that two got out alive is a miracle.
It was supposed to be a routine door knock. Four young police officers called to a remote property 3 hours west of Brisbane in search of a missing Dubbo school principal. We now know they were walking into an ambush.
As soon as they'd entered the property, they were just inundated with gunfire. They had no idea that they were walking into what would be the end of their lives.
29-year-old Constable Rachel McCrow and 26-year-old Constable Matthew Arnold gunned down execution style.
When their two colleagues who were passed away were on the ground, they were then executed in cold blood by these people who showed no compassion in any way, shape or form.
Incredibly, the two other officers narrowly escaped, the heavily armed shooters lighting a fire to try to smoke out a young female cop who'd been on the force just 8 weeks.
She did not know whether she was going to be shot or she was going to be burnt alive. I do know she was sending messages to loved ones saying she almost was at a point where she thought it was her time.
A 58-year-old neighbour, Alan Dare, who came to investigate the fire, was fatally shot in the back before reinforcements arrived. 16 officers risking their lives to retrieve the bodies.
You have to get in there. And they did that extraordinarily well, knowing that they were going to be under fire.
6 hours after the ambush began, it ended in a gunfight.
The matter was unable to be resolved peacefully, and all three offenders were fatally shot by specialist officers.
The offenders? Missing man Nathaniel Train, his brother Gareth Train, who owned the property, and Gareth's wife Stacey. Their motive is unclear, but Gareth was reportedly deeply involved with an online conspiracy community posting about his mistrust of police and alternative theories about the Port Arthur massacre.
Can you rule out whether one of the offenders had called the police to come to that property?
No, we can't rule anything out at the moment.
Investigations continuing as the nation reels.
It is an extremely emotional and challenging time for the Queensland Police Service.
Matthew and Rachel, they pay the ultimate sacrifice by simply doing their job.
Those officers will never, ever be forgotten. Ever. Their sacrifice will always be remembered. With honour they serve.
Ian Levers from the Queensland Police Union joins us now. Ian, first off, condolences to you, to your team, to all of your colleagues. This is a truly horrible incident. Does anything prepare you for this?
No, it doesn't. This is just one of those tragedies which was unforeseen, which should never, ever happen. And my colleagues here in Tara and Chinchilla are doing it really tough, and the ripple effect right around Queensland is hurting everyone, and it's spread right across Australia and New Zealand. But this was just a routine investigation that police were conducting. There was no intelligence to suggest that they may be at harm, and tragically, two lives of Matt and Rachel have been lost. And we are just so lucky that we did not lose Randall and Keeley as well. And their efforts were truly heroic in what they did in being able to ensure that other police were able to respond and do what they did. There was nothing to prevent these ruthless, murderous trio who were nothing but pure evil. When the neighbour went to investigate, he was ruthlessly shot in the back and died. That is just absolutely disgraceful that three innocent people have been murdered.
Ian, how are the families of the fallen officers holding up?
They're doing it really tough. I reached out to Rachel's mum and I'm yet to hear back, and I can only just imagine or trying to understand what she may be going through. I spoke with Matt's father last night, Terry. He's doing it really tough. He's in a state of disbelief that he's lost his son, who's only 26 years of age, who wanted a promising career in policing, as did Rachel. And they're going to live with this for the rest of their lives. And coming into the festive season, when families come together and they celebrate, this will be the darkest Christmas for Rachel's and Matt's family that they've ever had. And this will continue. But one thing at the police union, we will ensure their memories will live on. We will honour them and never forget them, because they paid the ultimate sacrifice because of the acts of some very evil, disturbed people.
Ian, there are reports that the offenders were wound up in conspiracy theories. What more do you know about that?
Look, we don't have that information at this point in time because, and from what I'm advised, this was a normal investigation in relation to inquiry for a missing person on behalf of New South Wales Police. And their risk assessment that they conducted, I would have done exactly the same, and I have over 30 years in policing. And although Rachel and Matt, they had just under 2 years policing experience, I would have done the same. It is just a tragedy, and this was certainly unforeseen, and they never could have predicted that what was about to take place. And when they entered into that yard, that would be the last moments of their life. But not only when they were shot, they were then cold-blooded, murdered and executed by these people.
It's a dark day in so many ways, of course, for the force, for the families of those who died. Ian, we appreciate you taking time out on a day like this to speak to us. Thanks so much.
Thank you, and thank you so much for your support and for the community across Australia. And what I've seen here in Chinchilla and Tara, the emotion and the public support is just unbelievable, and that keeps us going. And even knowing that the flower shops have sold out of flowers and the pain within the community, they're sharing it with police and we can work together. So thank you.
We hope that provides some comfort, Ian. Thank you. Thanks for your time.
Thank you.
Police Commissioner Katarina Carroll joins us now. Commissioner, it's so hard to know what to say. What a confronting day for you. How are you, and how's the rest of the police force holding up?
I think we're all travelling not too well at all. It's been a tragic day, a day of mourning across the QPS, the state and the country. I went in and saw my staff at Dalby, Chinchilla, met with the Tara officers, phoned the parents of our fallen officers, and met with and spoke to the two that survived. They have been incredibly difficult conversations and an incredibly difficult day for everyone concerned.
What you're asked to do at the best of times, let alone on a day like this, is just seems so unfathomable to all of us. Those phone calls with the families of the fallen officers, how are they doing?
They're not doing well. They're not doing well. Their colleagues aren't doing well. We're all in tears. We're all upset. In many ways, I think even angry, because it's hard to understand. You know, a call where you're protecting the community, it's very hard to fathom, to make sense of what's occurred. And that's, you know, we have the investigation now that started. We will get to the bottom of this. It seems callous. It seems senseless. It is one of the most tragic days in policing history.
Commissioner, you walked through the crime scene today. That must have been terribly confronting.
Yeah, I had to do that. I had to see what happened, where it happened, and try to get a sense of why it happened. What was very clear, is they didn't stand a chance. I cannot believe that two officers made it out of there and bravely did what they had to do to survive and to call for help. Sadly, we did lose two officers, though. And as I said, going to the crime scene and seeing what they were confronted with, in my opinion, it was not survivable.
I imagine there's something terrifying as well about the fact that this was such a routine police business, that this is not meant to end up in anything remarkable at all. Do you get this sense across the force that police are terrified or at the very least just shaken to do the very basics of their jobs?
I think definitely shaken. You know, we've heard from many officers, received many emails, many texts. These are routine calls. Police do thousands and thousands across the state every day. This was a routine call. Four officers who I know were happy to be there, joking, you know, enjoying the day. And what they encountered was just incredibly, incredibly difficult to understand.
Are you any closer to finding out what the motive behind this attack was?
This will be a thorough investigation. We have a lot of work to do. I anticipate this won't be over the next day or so. There is relatives to interview, friends to interview. At the end of the day, I and the community and the Queensland Police Service officers want to understand why this happened.
One of the strangest aspects of this is Nathaniel Train, who was missing for a year, and then he turns up in this context, which is, I mean, incredible. Was he actually missing, or does it turn out he was on the run?
No, we believe that he was genuinely missing for a year. And although there was phone contact, from what I understand, that stopped some days ago. So a person was concerned and police went there for a routine missing persons check. And sadly and devastatingly, this is how it's ended up.
One of the offenders, Gareth Train, was heavily involved in the online conspiracy community. Is that an avenue that you'll be investigating?
Yes, definitely, definitely. As I said, we will not leave a stone unturned. Every aspect of their lives will be investigated, interrogated. Everyone who had contact with them over a period of time, it will be a very thorough, and it is going to be a very complex investigation. But for myself as the commissioner, I need to explain to the community and to the Queensland Police, and particularly to the parents of those officers and those that survive, what happened here, so that we can understand better for the future. But we do need to know.
Police Commissioner, we thank you very much for your time and our condolences once again.
A sincere thank you.